reaches to heaven. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice flows just like the ocean tide. And I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my strength in the shadows of your wings. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky.
Worship. I will never Good morning and welcome to St. Genevieve Catholic Church. We're grateful for your presence and participation at this Mass. We would like to extend a hand of welcome especially to our guests. In order to respect the dignity and solemnity of today's celebration and to ensure a space for prayer and worship, please turn off and put into silent mode all electronic devices. Our opening song this morning will be We Are Many Parts. It's number 733 in Gather, number 733, if you'd like to get that ready. The fall issue of our Bayou Catholic is now available. Please pick up a free copy by the doors of church on your way out. Our Catholic Daughters of America have launched their annual school supply drive this month. Please help a student in need. Any school supplies you can provide will help with this. Drop-off boxes are available by the doors of church. We appreciate your generosity. As we begin our celebration, let us stand and join the opening hymn, We Are Many Parts, 733 in Gather.
We are many parts, we are all one body. of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory.
Protector of those who hope in you, without whom nothing has firm foundation, nothing is holy. Bestow in abundance your mercy upon us, and grant that with you as our ruler and guide, we may use the good things that pass in such a way as to hold fast even now to those that ever endure. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second book of Kings. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing to Elisha the man of God 20 barley loaves made from the first fruits and fresh grain in the ear. Elisha said, "Give it to the people to eat." But his servant objected, "How can I set this before 100 people?" Elisha insisted, "Give it to the people to eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and there shall be some left over." And when they had eaten, there was some left over, as the Lord had said. The word of the Lord.
The hand of the Lord. Let them discourse of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might. The hand of the Lord feeds us. He answers all our needs. The eyes of all look hopefully to give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The hand of the Lord feeds us. He answers all our needs. The Lord is just in all his ways, and holy in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. The hand of the Lord feeds us, he answers all our
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, I, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. One body and one spirit, as you were also called to the one hope of your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Has arisen in our midst. God has visited his people.
With you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus went across the Sea of Galilee. A large crowd followed him because they saw the signs he was performing on the sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. The Jewish feast of Passover was near. When Jesus raised his eyes and saw that a large crowd was coming to him, he said to Philip, "Where can we buy enough food for them to eat?" He said this to test him, because he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 200 days' wages worth of food would not be enough for each of them to have a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good are these for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people recline." Now there was a great deal of grass in that place. So the men reclined, about 5,000 in number. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed them to those who were reclining, and also as much of the fish as they wanted. When they had had their fill, he said to his disciples, "Gather the fragments left over so that nothing will be wasted." So they collected them and filled 12 wicker baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves that had been more than they could eat. When the people saw the sign he had done, they said, "This is truly the prophet, the one who is to come into the world." Since Jesus knew that they were going to come and carry him off to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain alone. The Gospel of the Lord. So as one Franciscan friar told me many years ago, there is no party like a Catholic party, because a Catholic party doesn't stop, which means the idea that the Catholic party is one that will continue forever when we get to heaven. And I was reminded of that because last week I was part of probably one of the biggest Catholic parties, Catholic gatherings that has ever happened here in our nation. I just came back from attending the National Eucharistic Congress. Great, wonderful experience, wonderful gathering. So many things to still unpack about the many wonderful blessings and experiences I have had attending this particular thing. Of course, I also have a claim to fame with this, that for about 2 seconds, I made it to the EWTN. A lot of people said that they saw me on television, and so I kind of like said that this made me kind of famous for at least 2 seconds of my life. But one of the highlights of this particular experience that I had last week was something that happened the last night of the gathering on Saturday night. And on that night, the nights were usually the big events. These were where everybody gathers into the stadium and just listen to some big name speakers gave talks about their faith. And on Saturday night, I say this as my highlight because one of the things that happened was that Jesus literally came and gave a talk. Now, if you're wondering what I'm talking about, I'm referring to Jonathan Rumi. Jonathan Rumi, if you're familiar with him, played the character of Jesus in the series The Chosen. And he is a very on-fire Catholic. He was very on fire with his faith. He's so inspiring with his faith. And so he was invited to give a talk that Saturday night. And he showed up and gave this talk. And at the end of his talk, he read John chapter 6. Like, he ended his talk with reading John chapter 6. But what's cool about it was he read the passage of John chapter 6 in the character of his TV Jesus. You know, so he read it with a Jewish accent, the accent that he used when playing Jesus in The Chosen. And so I was listening to it, and I would close my eyes, and I would feel like it was truly TV Jesus speaking to me. So it was a very cool experience for me. But what made this more exciting for me was that the John chapter 6 that he read that night actually sets up for us our gospel readings for the next couple of Sundays. Today, beginning today and for the next 5 Sundays, we're going to be focusing on John chapter 6, more popularly known as the Bread of Life discourse. And the fact that this year, when we are supposed to be focusing liturgically on the Gospel of Mark, we are interrupted with that journey with this John chapter 6 for 5 Sundays. And of all the passages that could have inserted themselves into this, it's John chapter 6, which goes to show the importance and truly the invitation for us to go deeper into this particular passage. And so let's kind of dive in into this journey beginning today. And so the John chapter 6, as it's going to be unpacked for the next 5 Sundays, begins with the story of the miracle of the 5,000. That's what we heard in today's gospel. Now, what's interesting about this story, about this miracle, is that it is the only miraculous event that's found in all 4 gospels. No other miracle stories ever made it to all 4, except for this particular one. And today we hear John's version of this passage, of this event. So how do we approach this? How do we reflect upon this? Well, one thing that we will need to know about John is that there are times when he would reveal the message of his passages through the little details. That oftentimes it's not in the big events, but the little details that are even a little bit insignificant or something that we could easily gloss over, that it is in those details that he reveals to us the message of that passage. So for example, just taking it from our passage today, he was very emphatic about saying that they were asked to sit on a big piece of grassy land. Now for us, it doesn't mean anything. Yeah, sure, it was just there. But there are two things that point us or that makes it significant about the detail of the grassy land. First is that it shows that John was truly an eyewitness because he's revealing details that no other writers have ever seen. So he's saying that he was there because he was able to see that they were sitting on grass. The second thing is that it points to a significant passage in the Old Testament, because there is one passage in the Old Testament where people are being asked to recline or to sit on grassy lands. And that's in Psalm 23, where it said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down on green pastures." Again, setting up in this little detail that the Jesus who's going to be feeding them is the good shepherd who will lay down his life, and that life that he will give up as the shepherd will become the bread that will give us life. And so there are a couple of details that are inviting us to reflect upon in today's class, but I'd just like to point two details that are very significant for us this morning. The first is the little boy's offering of 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. And the second is that when they gather everything that was left over, there were 12 wicker baskets full of fragments. Now 12 for the Israelites is a very significant number, because 12 refers to the 12 tribes of Israel. And therefore, when a first century Jew reads this particular passage and reads something about 12, it immediately brings to his mind that Jesus is initiating the regathering of the 12 tribes of Israel. And therefore, that he is truly the Messiah that the Father will send to bring back Israel, but that the 12 tribes will be gathered through the breaking of the bread. So that's a very significant detail there. But more importantly, combining these two details, it points us to the fact that John wants to emphasize that there truly was a miracle of multiplication. And the reason that we have to be aware of this is because there is a competing translation or interpretation of this passage that began in the 19th century, where it tries to deny that there actually was no miracle that happened. It's an interpretation introduced by a German Protestant scholar by the name of Heinrich Paulus. He is also a rationalist, meaning that he embraced this philosophy that everything always has a reason that can be empirically measured, that there is no such thing as supernatural or miracle. And what he was pushing for is this interpretation that there actually was no multiplication that happened, but rather that it was merely a miracle of sharing. Because according to him, what happened was that everybody brought pieces of bread, but they refused to share them and just kept it to themselves until they saw the little boy offering this to Jesus and Jesus starting to share this. And they felt guilty about it. And so they brought out their bread and they started sharing. And that's why everybody had enough bread to eat to feed them. But what was wrong about this interpretation was that nothing in the gospel, nothing in the passage shows that. That John, who was an eyewitness, did not say anything about that. He clearly said that everything that all the people ate came from the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. In fact, he was so emphatic about it that he repeated this at the end by saying that the 12 wicker baskets came again from those 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. So there's nothing there that says that it was just simply sharing, but truly a miracle of multiplication happened. That from the 5 loaves, Jesus broke it down and was able to feed everybody else. And that's very important for us because it sets us up, or it provides us with one of the most compelling reasons for the real presence of Jesus in the Eucharist. Because just as Jesus is able to multiply 5 loaves of bread and be able to give it to everybody, he also can multiply his presence and be really present in all of the hosts that we will encounter at all of the masses all over the world. That with the same power and authority that Jesus did to make those 5 loaves something that everybody can have and be satisfied, Same thing with his body too, with his presence. He can make himself multiply. And every little fragment of host we encounter that is offered at Mass is his body without losing the integrity of his whole body. And this is something of a comfort for each one of us, because it truly shows us that whatever we encounter here at Mass, the host that we see here, the host that we encounter here, that it truly becomes the real presence of Jesus for us. And we encounter him, his real presence in sacramental form here. But more importantly, if Jesus is truly present in the Eucharist, in all of the hosts that we encounter here, then it also makes sense to each one of us that the thing that's most attacked by the world today is the Eucharist and every form, every expression of our belief in it, everything that leads to it. If I'm just going to give you an example of how this has become truly the biggest attack that we could ever see in the world, if you're on social media yesterday, you know what I'm talking about. You know, if you're on social media, you know the outrage is happening recently with what just happened a couple of days ago. Now, I have not seen the opening ceremony. Therefore, I cannot give an eyewitness analysis of whether it truly was a mockery of the Last Supper and the Eucharist. But here's one thing that I can see. If it truly was a mockery, then we have every right to be outraged. We have every right to be angry about it, for it attacks the central tenet of our faith. But it should also be comforting for us. It should also be something that should console us. Because this is what I always say, the devil will always attack those places or those things where Jesus is truly present to be with us. The devil will never attack anything that does not have Jesus in it. And therefore, if the devil is using this to attack us, that means Jesus is really present in the Eucharist and in our expression of it. And that should give us hope today, that no matter how much the world attack us, it will only attack because Jesus is in us. Jesus is present to us. And it should be a place of hope for us. It should be comforting for us. And it should help us to know that if we truly want to seek Jesus, if we truly want to find him, we do not have to go anywhere else. We just have to look at the host offered at Mass here, the Eucharist, because here Jesus is truly present and he comes to us in his entire form. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the miracle of feeding 5,000 people, our Lord shows us that the Father will give us everything we need. Let us ask him for the good gifts he can provide for us. For the pastors of our church, especially the Pope and the bishops, that they may continue to nourish us with sound doctrine, let us pray to the Lord. For people who hunger for Christ, that they may find the one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, let us pray to the Lord. for this assembly of the faithful, that we may love Jesus Christ as he gives himself to the multitude in the Eucharist. Let us pray to the Lord. The third intercession of Our Lady of Prompt Supper, our Lord will spare us during this hurricane season from all harm, and will protect us, our homes, and our properties from all disasters of nature. Let us pray to the Lord. And for the faithful departed, that they may come to the eternal feast in God's kingdom, let us pray to the Lord. Most merciful Father, hear the prayers of the people you have gathered to offer and receive the eternal gift, Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Please join in singing our offertory song, All That We Have, 601 and Gather, 601.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the offerings which we bring from the abundance of your gifts, that through the powerful working of your grace, these most sacred mysteries may sanctify our present way of life and lead us to eternal gladness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy, for you are the one God, living and true, existing before all ages and abiding for all eternity, dwelling in an approachable light. Yet you, who alone are good, a source of life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so in your presence are countless hosts of angels who serve you day and night, and gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. With them we too confess your name in exaltation, giving voice to every creature under heaven as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts.
Praise, Father most holy, for you are great and you have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You form man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death, for you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offer them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so love the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior. Made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he shared a human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, and to the sorrowful of heart joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may this same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, for the celebration of this great mystery, which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant a merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace on our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your
spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Those joining us on social media, please pray with me and act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated. join me in singing our communion song, We Come to Your Feast, number 850 and gather, number 850 and gather.
Young and behold, the frightened, the bold, the
Let us pray. We have consumed, O Lord, this divine sacrament, the perpetual memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift, which he himself gave us with love beyond all telling, may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Our closing song is Sing a New Song, number 537 in Gather. 537.